Jesus, I'm leaning on your name. Oh, I'm leaning on you. I'm leaning on you. I'm leaning on you. I'm leaning on you. Can help me, Jesus can. Every other name is sinking sand. Even when my heart don't understand, Jesus, I will trust you even then.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Jesus Name Ministries. We're glad you're here, and we just want to thank you for joining Jesus Name Ministries today. We are about to get started here. We'd like to go before the Lord in prayer this morning and just ask God that He would take control. Amen. God would move and speak to your heart. Amen. And speak in your soul today. Speak to your ears that you might hear. Amen. And we just thank you for joining today. We're very thankful that God has given us another day. Amen. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. Amen. 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 All right. Well, Lord, we just pray that you would move mightily. God, in our stead today, God, let your word go out and cleanse and wash and regenerate us, Lord Jesus, and help us, Lord Jesus, to find you in ways that we have never seen you in, God. And we just ask you, Lord, that you would mightily move, God, among the listeners, God, today. And God, we just pray that we can bring them you, Jesus. Amen. For you are life. Amen. And there is none other that we could look on and depend on. Amen. In this life or after, Lord. We just praise you, God, today. We pray, God, for healing in their families. We pray, God, for minds today. God, that you would help them. Lord, we know there is just troubling times today, God. And we just pray, God, that through all that, you will give them peace, Lord. You will give us peace, God, that we, God, may be a light unto this world. God, that we would be the salt of the earth, Lord, as you had told us to be, Lord. And we, Lord, want that life more abundantly. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Do you have life? Do you have it more abundantly? Because that is exactly what Jesus came to offer us. He said, I will give you life more abundantly. Amen. If you're living that life more abundantly, amen, you know exactly what I'm talking about today. But today, we are going to talk about some things here today. We're talking about a money-changing Jesus. We're going to talk about mimicking spirits. We're going to be talking about the doctrines of devils. We're going to help you understand that that is alive and well today. Amen. This Bible, this Word of God is live. Jesus made it alive through His Spirit. Amen. If you have the Spirit of the Holy Ghost this morning, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Amen. You have His Spirit living within you. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Yes. Amen. So let's get into, we're going to talk about several things today. Amen. And we're going to get to the Word here soon. But I just want to say that the Bible says, for the time will come when they shall not endure sound doctrine. What is sound doctrine? That means Jesus, about Jesus. So when we talk about sound doctrine, we talk about, we're talking about origins. So as you read, when someone tells a story, it gets further and further away from the subject. And that, my friend, is where we're at today. Today, people are so far from Jesus. They have moved away from the subject. And these so-called churches, and I'm going to say it just like it is. I'm going to preach it and tell you what it is today. When you look at these false teachers, when you look at these false church functions, the system that has been put into place, we have error. We have people that are so far from Jesus today, what Jesus came to do, that people don't even find Jesus in churches today. It's sad to say, but that is the truth. Amen. And a lot of people don't like the truth. They will tell you, well, that's not true. That guy is not right. He's not blah, blah, blah. I don't really care. I'm just purporting the gospel of Jesus. I want you to know what Jesus said. Amen. I could care less what you think of me as long as I teach Jesus, as long as I tell you about the one who set me free and how he can set you free. Amen. That is who I want the subject to be today. Amen. I'm nobody. I love that song. I'm just a nobody trying to tell somebody all about somebody that saved my soul. Amen. I know I got those words a little mixed up, but that is what I'm about today. I want you to know who Jesus is. Amen. And I could care less what you think of me because I'm just a nobody. Amen. Trying to tell everybody all about somebody that saved my soul. Amen. And that's where we're at today. That's what I want you to know is about Jesus, the real Jesus, not the one they're preaching today, not the Jesus in the box. Amen. I'm not talking about that Jesus that's in the box today, that they have put in the box. They have put man ahead and before Jesus. That priesthood is alive and well today. It is not what Jesus came to do. Amen. By any means, nor stretch of the imagination. Let me tell you today. So anyhow, I want you to know that Jesus loves you and he came to give you life more abundantly. Not just life, but vibrant life. Life that it will save your soul. Life that is forever and eternal. Not just some little Mickey Mouse, Disney World, fantasy for a weekend, Jesus. We're talking about the real Jesus, the money-changing Jesus. Now, why did I call this the money-changing Jesus? Well, you see, the money-changing Jesus, see, we've got this thing about money, right? Money stands of great importance in our society today. Amen. Money is what people look at as value and worth. Amen. So when you look at it, there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Amen. Money today is what people cling to. Money is representation of value. Money can buy things. Money can build your status. Money can make you more important. Money can give you power in this life. Amen. But you see, money can't buy the joy that the Holy Ghost will bring to you. Amen. So anyhow, we just wanted to take the excerpt of Matthew 21 and 12. Where Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all of them that sold and bought in the temple. All them that bought and sold in the temple. Just notice here. He cast out all of them. Not only the ones that was peddling, but the ones that was receiving the peddlers. And he overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. Let's just break this down in representation. Now, why did this story even make the Bible? Because everybody wants to think Jesus was just a calm, peaceful person, man that lived on the earth, that showed us exactly how to act. Amen. And we're not to get angry. The Bible said to be angry and sin not. And Jesus went in to prove a point, to teach his disciples a very important lesson here. And what Jesus was telling them and showing them in this demonstration was that what religion is, where it stood, and what their belief system is, and how important they took it. And again, I find this very interesting that Jesus not only cast out them that sold, he didn't just get rid of the drug dealer, he got rid of the drug users. Because if it wasn't for the drug users, the dealers probably wouldn't have been there. So the enablers and the supplier. So let me tell you a little bit here this morning about the churches today. So we've got some enablers we've got the suppliers because of the enablers. See, if people weren't grasping, weren't looking for, amen. He said, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. That's what Paul told Timothy. 2 Timothy 4:1 or 4:5 we just read. So do you think Jesus chose money to leave one of the most profound memories of his actions while here on earth? The very heart of wealth and power is currency. And in the sum of representation, aka spendable coin, dollar value, who did Jesus cast out? We just talked. All of them, the sellers and the buyers, the hypocrites and those that believe the hypocrites. He said, if the blind lead the blind, then shall they not both fall into the ditch? So, not just the leader, but the follower. Jesus made no qualms about who was not going to make it. Not just the deceiver was going to go where it was going to be prohibited from heaven. It was those that followed the deceivers. That's why so many times in the New Testament, the New Covenant, Jesus spoke, even the apostles spoke, that there are people that bring false doctrine. And he even said, there are people that are even being apostles, saying they're apostles. But that's no big deal, because he said, don't think it's strange that Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Do you not think his ministers are going to be also? They're going to call themselves. Jesus said that in Revelation he talked. He said, I know them that at the seat of Satan who call themselves of God, but are not. You found them out. And we talked last week about how cancer, how it is so pervasive, how it is a number one killer of human life. And the simple reason why it is because of the fact that it hides, it disguises itself as good. And your immune system does not detect it. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that something? Because Jesus spoke so much about the deception of man. Very few times did he blame it on the devil. Very few times. He said the devil's always looking. But man is who you got to watch for. That's in your Bible. That's in the King James. That's in many translations of the New Testament, what we call the New Covenant of Jesus Christ. So the false teachers and those that support the false teachers, the fake man-made religion and those that contribute to it, the bent away with fake priesthood and those that support that fake priesthood. And if you wonder, oh, well, with the priesthood, we're going to talk a little bit about it, but not on the side that we're talking about now. But that priesthood is done away. We talked about it last week. You'll go to our YouTube channel. There are many messages talking about that, showing you scripturally why it is done away. The church buildings and those that support the church buildings, on and on and on, the fake religions of our day. Jesus said in John 4:23, but the hour cometh and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Verse 24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So we see here where 2 Corinthians 11 and 13, it said, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Now, who were the apostles? The apostles were the select that Jesus chose to begin this gospel, the telling of Jesus. What is the gospel? Preach the gospel unto all nations. Amen. And when you look at that great commission, as we call it today, preach the gospel. Don't preach the pastor. Don't preach the false apostles. Don't preach the fraudsters. Don't preach the doctrines of devils. Don't preach lying spirits. Don't mimic the Spirit of God if you don't have the goods. And if you have the goods, you're not mimicking. If there are false apostles in their day, what do you think there is in our day? Extortioners, imposters, heretics, gone from the way of Jesus. I'm not talking about gone from the way your church policies are. I'm not talking about your church corporation, your so-called standards, your so-called rules. If you have life and you have it more abundantly, if Jesus truly set you free, then you are free indeed by the Son of Man. This is a problem because you're not free in a church. They have rules. They have a policy. And these idiots that say, oh, God is a God of not chaos. He's a God of rules. He's a God of order. Only ones professing that is the one that are high up in that order so that they can be over you. That's where they're at. These are the frauds. But you see, there's going to be a penalty to these fraudulent people, to these false teachers. Proverbs 13 and 5 on the screen there. The righteous hate what is false. If you're righteous, you hate that stuff. Now, there's a problem if you're not hating it. You do the math. You do the word game there. But the wicked make themselves a stench, a stink, and bring shame on themselves. All this fraud will bring a penalty. There is a penalty. What kind of penalty we have? Well, eventually, it's going to land you in the lake of fire. I want to bring up something here. The Moses, everybody knows Moses brought the Ten Commandments. We all have heard, we've probably seen the Ten Commandments on TV. But Moses' brother was appointed, and his sons were appointed. So Aaron was his brother, and he was appointed the high priest. And that was to take care. They said, okay, well, you're gonna be part of this. You're gonna take care of the Ark of God. You're gonna take care of the things that the furniture and furnishings of God, the golden candlesticks. And if you don't know the Old Testament, you may not know what I'm talking about. But there is a, we're talking about the old tabernacle. Amen. The things that bring us to Christ, the understanding of the Spirit that Jesus was to bring and how it was to transpire. This is talking about the children of Israel, the select house of God. Amen. In the Old Testament. And when I say the Old Testament, it's called the Old Testament because it's old. It's not today. It's not for you. It's not for me. That's why it's called the Old Testament. A testament is the will of God. And once the testator, the Bible tells us, has passed, that's when the will kicks in. And we're talking about when Jesus came on the scene. See, here's the big kicker. Jesus leveled the whole playing field. We're going to get into that in a minute. But we're talking about Aaron, the high priest, and his sons. These mimicking spirits, these, now understand, Moses was the top guy. He, when God dealt with man in the Old Testament, he chose a man to speak to through man to speak to his children. Now, what's significant about that is the Old Testament. That is a way of way God that chose to bring forth his presence after the Garden of Eden, after Adam and Eve sinned, that broke away that communication. See, God would just speak to them in the cool of the day. He didn't need to say, oh, Adam, you talk to Eve. No, he would just come in and say, good morning, whatever he said. But he would talk directly to them. But once sin entered, it separated. And now there became ordinances by man. And that divided God from man. So man had to arise to the occasion. God would choose man to lead. And this was the form that he chose in the early times of man's creation. Now, as it is today, we are in the New Testament. We have the New Covenant. A covenant is a pact. It is a sign by blood, in this case, by Jesus. There is a new and living way. The Old Testament is old. Now, unless you're a nostalgic person or a collector of history, old is not the end thing. Old is not what you want. Again, unless you're a collector of some of that stuff, you're not wanting to go to the car lot and find an old car that's not very dependable. You want something new, fresh, that's going to start up when you hit the key, or when you push the button in this case, or tell it to start with Bluetooth. Anyhow, so you had Aaron, the high priest. He had his two oldest sons. He had four sons. And the Bible talks about his two oldest sons decided when they brought sacrifice and when they put the fire. See, there was, I'm not going to go into all the Old Testament this morning. But when they brought fire, they didn't bring it from the right place. And when they brought that fire, the Bible calls it strange fire. And when they did, Nadab and Abihu, the two oldest sons of Aaron, the main man of God's two oldest nephews, God killed them right there on the spot because they took strange fire and put on the altar of God. And that stench we talked about in Proverbs, that those that love righteousness, those that want truth, those that don't, is a stench to God. It's a stink. And they put this strange fire out. And when God saw it, he killed both of them right there on the spot. That's what Proverbs 16 and 25 says, there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. But you see, God don't play favorites. Because if ever there was a time that God was going to play some favorites here, it would have been then. You see, then was the time that God could have played a favorite and said, you know, it's the my main man's brother's two oldest sons. And you know, that would just really, really send out a bad message, you know. But you know what? Man thinks of that, but God is not wavering. God is a fair God. He's a just God. And the problem is that a lot of times we don't get justice. So I want to talk about another person. When we look at Samson in Judges 16 and 20, that he was comfortable. He had gotten so used to the grace of God. He had gotten so used to God being there. No matter what he did, God showed up. He could live his life however he wanted. He could go outside of what he was told to do, and God would still show up. And we find in Judges 16 and 20 that a day and a time came when he had shook himself as before. And he didn't know. The Bible says he wist not that the Lord or the Spirit of God had left him, because the Spirit of God would come on him and give him strength to fight. And I'll let you go look at the Samson and Delilah story, and you can see that. My point today is we have a generation. Jesus said in Matthew 12 and 34, ye generation of vipers. Ye generation of vipers. He said, always seeking a sign. Always looking for something. But you can't do the simple things that you're supposed to do. You're not loving truth. And I want to talk about, we're talking about a money-changing Jesus. We're talking about when he changed things. God did not intend to keep going on with the old law. God did not come to just rehash mankind again. He did not come just to have the same old, same old. You see, this is why Israel has the biggest problem of accepting Jesus Christ as their Messiah. Because what they was looking for was what they was looking for. They thought they had it all figured out. They thought, hey, you know what? He's going to show up before like he did always. And just like Samson, he didn't come in the way that they wanted him to come, that they had anticipated. And Jesus said, you generation of vipers. Paul told Timothy, they want seducing spirits. They're moved by seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Who might the doctrines of devils be? Who is bringing forth this junk? No other than man. I'm pretty sure if the devil had a forum, if he had a stage in New York, there would be plenty of people to pay the ticket price no matter what would go see him. But you see, it doesn't come like that. It comes through man. See, the devil mimics what God has intended. See, he moves over man in evil. But when you give it to Jesus, he moves through peace in the Holy Ghost. Amen. You generation of vipers, you're always seeking a sign. He said, you know what kind of sign you're going to get? The same sign I gave to Jonas, who ended up in the whale's belly. 3 days. Let's talk about fraud. Let's talk about the offense. This is what is not taught today. This is what's not understood of the weight of those that are deceiving you. If they knew the weight, if they knew the penalties, not only in this life, but the life to come of what they're doing, I'm pretty sure they'd stop. But it's the same way with drug peddlers. I mean, they're not getting caught. There's no immediate action. There's no immediate death. And just like Adam and Eve, there was no immediate death. So in one part, the devil was right. Thou shalt not surely die. Well, no, you're not going to die physically right now. But the death comes as a spiritual death. Because we are created in God's image, we became a living soul. A soul will never die. This flesh will go back to the ground, the dust where it was created from. But the soul shall never die. We, my friend, will be forever. But the big problem is where will you spend your forever? We must be born again, Jesus said, of the water and of the Spirit. Well, you cannot see or enter into the kingdom of God. And you can find that in St. John 1, or 3, 1 through 8, where he's talking to Nicodemus. He said, how can I be born again? And Jesus began to tell him. And we find that Jesus gave that message to Peter. And when the time of Pentecost was fully come, he moved on Peter through and by the Holy Ghost to speak the keys of life to the kingdom. And as I said before on Facebook, that if you understand the keys was a one-off thing. Peter wasn't given some status of carrying the keys around to the kingdom. Those were words that the Holy Ghost brought on to Peter to speak for salvation, the plan of salvation that you and I also could use, obey, and bring forth and give out to other people. So let's go through these just as a matter of law today. The Fraud Act of 2006, okay, defines fraud as a crime that falls into one or more of three separate categories. The first is fraud by false representation. I want you to kind of look at this in a spiritual sense. What are pastors doing today? What are the Catholic priests? What are these cardinals? What is the Pope? They're falsely representing Jesus Christ. where a person dishonestly makes a false representation What's that mean? And intends by making the representation to make gain for himself or another, or to cause loss to another, or to expose another to a raw risk or loss. You digest that. There's a lot of false teaching going on here today. They have put man's laws above God's. If you are made free, my friend, how in the world are you brought back under subjection to man? Second is fraud by failing to disclose information. Look at that from a spiritual sense. Look at that in these churches. Look at that in these preachers. Look at that in these pastors. Where a person dishonestly fails to disclose to another person information which he is under a legal duty to disclose and intends by failing to disclose the information to make a gain for himself or another, or to cause loss to another, or to expose another to a risk or loss, and fraud by abuse of position. I don't know. When I read this, I see these churches all over the place. I see these pastors lying. They're not preaching Jesus. They call themselves Jesus' name. They call themselves oneness. They call themselves, oh, we're of Christ. Jesus said, lo, they will say, here is Christ. Go not there. Hey, I'm Christ. Oh, I'm about Christ. Oh, that man, you got to go hear him preach. He's got it. What's he got? The third is fraud by abuse of position. Position. Imagine that. Where Jesus said in 20, 25 and 26 of Matthew that there would be no positions among you, among his people. He told that to the apostles. Because two of the apostles' mothers said, hey, I want one to sit on each side of you when they get to heaven. He said, it doesn't work that way. He said, see how the world does it. That's not going to happen among you. One is your master, me. But what do we got in all these churches? We have hierarchy. We have corporations. We got people trying to climb up the corporate ladder. Oh, you got to listen to so-and-so, and here's how it works in this church, and blah, 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 and here's so-and-so, and oh, brother so-and-so, and sister so-and-so. They do this, and you got to go to them for that. What are you talking about? You left Jesus way back there. You have no idea who you're serving. If you're putting up with that garbage and you're calling that church, it's church all right. It ain't God's church. Where a person occupies a position in which he is expected to safeguard or not to act against the financial interest of another person, do you know where the money you go gives to these churches goes? It's all well, pays the utilities and blah, 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 blah. Does it really? Oh, it may. It may contribute to that. But what are you contributing to? Are you going to be able to stand before Jesus when he says, when seen are you taking care of that hungry person? You know, all God gave to the church. Are you serious? Do you really believe that garbage? That does not convert to you helping a person. Or we have a soup kitchen, or we have this and that. Well, that's all good and fine, but did you do something? Well, I gave to it. Well, you're getting close. But I don't know how God's going to treat that. Neither do you. So I would make sure that my money went to the people affected. not in the stead of someone else to make that choice for you. See, Jesus never set any of that up. I don't care what anybody says, what any scripture, there's nothing shown by what Jesus said or did to prove any of that. So if you want to buy that, that's up to you. When Jesus said that my words will judge you in the last day, and you can't find them to support what you did, sorry, I don't, you can't say, well, Peter said this or Paul said that. It doesn't matter. You see, they were to bring the gospel, who Jesus was, bring you to Jesus. Where a person occupies a position which he is expected to safeguard and not to act against the financial interest of another person, but dishonestly abuses that position and intends, by means of the abuse of that position, to make a gain for himself or another, and that could be not just financial, that could be prestige, or to cause loss to another or to expose another to a risk of loss. Now, these are just the three main fraudulent offenses. And their penalties are prison. Now, you could be 18 months, you could be 4 to 30 years. These are the penalties. This is not a slap on the wrist. And this is plus fines and restoration of what you did wrong to the people you did it wrong to. So nobody really gets the weight of this false preaching, this false teaching. They don't understand that there is huge penalties that they're going to have to pay in the end. And we talked last week about the manipulation, the skill by which these people, these so-called preachers, these so-called pastors, the skill by which they lie in wait, the Bible says, and use of cunning words. Cunning words and stories and man. A friend of mine had just told me that they had visited a church not too long ago. They said when they went in there, there was coffee shops. Let me
just check here. I'm pretty sure that they even said a smoke shop. Forgive me if I misread this, but I could be wrong. But coffee shops, you name it. This place was decked out with stuff that. And just to allure people, to bring people to church. Now understand, I get compelling people. Amen. I get compelling people. But it was described to me, the theater and the lights, fog machines, and just amazing of what they had built. To get people. What the Bible talks about as luring people in is not things of this world, my friend. That's not what the scripture's talking about. It's talking about the love of Jesus. Amen. If you don't want the love of Jesus, no snow cone machine, no hair salon in the church is going to keep you loving Jesus. Understand, there's no worldly thing. It's going to perish with the using. When the cotton candy ran out, people aren't showing up. And if you can't give them Jesus, You've given them nothing. Amen. If you can't bring Jesus into their life, if you can't show them the way, then you have failed what Jesus told us to do. And I want to, this is where we was talking earlier about the generation of vipers. He said, "O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh." And then we'll drop down to 37, said, "For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." Again, the weight of these things, people are missing the weight, the penalty of not. And what do you say here? "An evil and adulterous generation seeking after a sign, and there shall be no sign given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas." And again, this is in Matthew 12:38-40. "For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be there, and there 3 nights in the heart of the earth." He was speaking about where he was going to go for you and I. See, the big issue, the big problem, for mankind, for believing Jesus, the biggest change. See, Jesus leveled the playing field. Jesus took what the Jews, they can't buy this. They're not buying this because they were the chosen. They were the special people. But because of their disobedience, you see, the Lord talks about the olive branch. And he says, you know, the true vine, the selected tree was Israel. He's the root. He's the feeding of that. And Jesus said that he was the branch. And when you look at that, Jesus said, "I have cut off Israel." And in part, Paul said, they are blinded. They do not have God. They, because of their unbelief, the same as in the 40 years that God put them in the wilderness, till generation run out, because of their unbelief. He said, "He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, shall have eternal life, will not perish." John 3:16, you know the quote. But you see, Jesus leveled the playing field. And I want to just go to Isaiah real quick here, just to show you what was to come. What they had before them, what was told, and how they should have seen it. But in my reading of the scripture, it appears that they were intentionally blinded in part. You see, the scripture says, in Isaiah 53:2, speaking about Jesus, "For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." Now I want to focus on, "For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground." Can you imagine a root coming out of dry ground. See, we water. When we plant something, we keep it watered. So why? So that the earth is supple. It is able to give way by means of moisture, that it could be pliable, malleable to allow the plant to spring up. But he had to enter this world out of dry ground. He did not come to show us how to patty cake for Jesus. He did not come and bring the same old, same old. No, Jesus brought a paradigm shift of who God's chosen were, and they now included the Gentiles. He broke that glass ceiling, if you will. He broke through that dry, parched ground. There was a jealousy by the Jews. They didn't want to accept Jesus. They did not accept Jesus. You see, in Acts chapter 15, verse 10. Let me just go there since I have this right here. And this was Peter. I'll just show you here. Verse 7, and when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, you know how that a good while ago God made choice among us. Now these were Jews. Peter was a Jew. He said, God made a choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. Verse 8, and God, which knoweth the hearts, bare them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us. And here's the kicker, verse 9. Now, you see, these churches want to have hierarchy, and, oh, I'm this, and I'm that, and I'm bigger, higher, and higher, and this is who you got to go to. And here's what Peter said, verse 9, and he put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now, you can say all you want. I know exactly the argument they would like to present. Oh, well, this is talking about the Jews and the Gentiles. Well, if you knew Jesus, you'd know that this plays right into Jesus saying ain't none greater than the other. You would know that, and you could accept this very easily, just by the way I said it. That he put no difference between us and them. And just for our audience today, I want to take you to Matthew 20, 25, 26, and there's Luke 22, 25, 26. I will not take you there today. I will not take the time, but you can go there too. These are different stories, but talking about the same thing. Let's just read it real quick. Then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, what wilt thou? And I'm just going to break down through here. Jesus answered and said, you know not what you ask. So she asked, can my sons be on your left and right side? Look it up, read the story. You know what? Not what you asked. He went and say, can they be baptized with the baptism? He's getting ready to go to the cross. And that's what he was talking about. And they say unto him, we are able. And he said unto them, ye shall drink indeed of my cup and be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with. But to sit on my right hand and my left is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared of my Father. And when the 10 heard it, the other disciples heard about the two and heard their mom wanting them to be special, they were moved with indignation against the two brethren. What is your problem? Why are you asking this of the master? You know he's not like that. Let's go to verse 25. But Jesus called them unto him and said, ye know that the princes of the Gentiles, the unbelievers, the heathen, exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. Verse 26, write it down, highlight it. But it shall not be so among you, but whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. So if there is a hierarchy, the great will be considered the less. They'll serve. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. How many churches exercise what Jesus just said? Zero. That's where we're at, folks. That's what they've got. That's what they've got to give you. They don't know the real Jesus. They're not teaching the real Jesus. It's not happening. The Holy Ghost made the priesthood obsolete. We talked about Aaron, the priesthood. And without going into the whole ordinances and all that stuff, there was a time when the priesthood would present the sacrifices unto God in the temple. It was the holiest of holies. There was the outer courts, the inner courts, with the shewbread, the candles and the laver and the altar and those things, and you can go online and you can go through all that. There's great studies out there for it. But these are types and shadows of things to bring us to Christ. These were sacrifices. This was showing what Jesus was about to come on the scene to do. He was that Lamb of God. And yet churches have altars. Why do they have an altar? You can never compare to the Lamb of God. You can never be the sacrifice. What you've got is nothing to God. Our righteousness is as filthy rags in the sight of God. Without Jesus Christ, we don't have God. He is the way, the life, and the truth. He is the door. No man can come but through Jesus. Again, the Holy Ghost replaced priesthood. The Holy Ghost replaced man between you and God, the holiest of holies. We now can come boldly to the throne of grace for acceptance in the time of need. He said that he's never very far from any one of us at any time. So why do I need man but to lead me to Jesus? After which, the Holy Ghost. After which, the Holy Ghost will lead and guide me into all truth and righteousness. My commitment, my life should therefore be to serve God with all my heart, all my mind, my soul, to love my neighbor, my brother as myself. That is the whole commandment, is to fear God and keep his commandments. The laws that are written on the tables of heart of your heart. Hebrews 10 and 16. He said, I will write my laws in their minds and in their hearts. David said, sacrifice I will give, but you're not looking for the sacrifice. He goes, the sacrifices to God is a pure heart and a contrite spirit. A broken heart and a contrite spirit. A condescending. Coming to God through the grace of Jesus Christ. For forgiveness of sins, to come back. To connect to God through grace, through that Lamb of God that John proclaimed that take away the sins of the world. There is no value in a priesthood. There is no value. There is no man, pastor, priesthood. You name it, there is no man who can stand in the stead for you. They can pray for you. Jesus prayed for you. That's enough. Jesus prayed for you. Read it for yourself. John 17 and 20. Neither pray I for these alone. Talking about the apostles. But for all them who believe on me through their word. What word were they to give to us to believe on? Jesus, to believe on me through their word, their testimony, their eyewitness account of being with me and seeing the miracles and understanding what I told them. That's what you're to believe on. Believe on me. He didn't say you go on over to Acts and the Corinthians and all these and you've got to be bound by churches and laws and all this stuff. That was not what Jesus said. But man has taken advantage. They have twisted. For their own benefit, they are benefactors. They have become the scribes and Pharisees of Jesus' day. He said, you can pass land and sea to convert one proselyte. And then when he is converted, you make them a twofold child of hell more than ye yourselves. You find me some areas where Jesus lifted up the call and purpose of a scribe and Pharisee church. It didn't happen. Jesus said, upon this rock, upon your confession of who I am, Peter, I will build my church. Now, if it was the scribes and Pharisee church, if it was the church of that day, if the religion of that day was okay, or if Jesus was going to fix it, he would have pointed to it. But he didn't. And this is what they leave out for you in these churches today. This is what they don't teach. This is what they're not telling you. This is not what they want you to know or hear. Because it does not fit their narrative. It does not fit their fame. It does not fit their fortune. So they're not going to tell you these things. They're not going to give you that truth. Amen. So when you look at that, what happened? The temple, Jesus said, would be destroyed. And it was in 70 AD. Look at your history books. Every stone came down. There's a variety of stories, and I'm not going to get into that, but they had melted, they burn it, and gold melted in all the stones, and so they when he said not one stone was going to be not turned over, some have said that that's why, that's how it really happened, because they found gold in the stones because it melted through the stones, and hey, every stone to get gold out. So that's just a little tidbit. But his spirit resides in the body that he made for us. He said that I will live. I will write my laws in their minds and in the tables of their heart. That's the spirit of God's habitation. And this Ephesians 2 and 22, he said, ye also are built together for a habitation of God through the Spirit, through his Spirit, through receiving his Holy Ghost. And he said in Hebrews 10 and 20, he brought a new and living way. Now we talked about Acts. We went to Acts and we talked about the I can go back there real quick again. And we can go down through here and we can talk here. Where Peter said, now therefore, verse 10, Acts 15 and 10, now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? You understand that? The law was not good enough. So why are churches today bringing over the old law? Why do they want the old law back in the church when the Bible said it wasn't good enough? It couldn't even remove sins. It could only push them back for another year. You had to have man who was consecrated, just like Aaron, the priesthood, his sons, who were fallible, who were struck dead by God because they offered strange fire. They veered away from what God told them. Just like the false prophets today, just like the money grubbers, just like those that are preaching tithing, which has no business being in any New Testament church, or an Old Testament church for all that matters. These things are they're heresies. They are away from Jesus. They don't know Jesus. And what they do know, they're lying to you about. Because they're bringing the old law in so that they can have power and rule over you. We just read one scripture. There's two others in two other gospels. Amen. And you can look at some of our other videos. We go into that in depth. But understand that Peter, the apostle Peter, who Jesus gave the keys to the kingdom to open up the plan of salvation for us, so that we could continue it on and preach that same gospel of Jesus Christ. So Peter, who the Lord gave it to open it up. And look here. When we look, we go here, and this is what they concluded. James, the brother of Jesus, came back and said, for as much as we have heard, and he's talking to the Gentiles, that certain which went out from us, these other apostles that came from us, have troubled you with words. He's talking to the Gentiles that was told, hey, you've got to obey the law. You've got to be circumcised. Here's the rules for you. You want to stay in this thing. We know Jesus gave you the Holy Ghost. God came down on you in a supernatural power came upon you. You spoke in other tongues. You touched God. We know you experienced God, and God has put peace and rest on you. But you need to be circumcised, and you need to keep the law. Here's the law. You study it and you obey it. And here comes Peter, or James. For as much as we heard that these Yahoos came out from us trying to trouble you with words, subverting your souls. That whole big happiness you had, they just put a big old damp on that fire you just had. They threw a bucket of water on your fire, saying you must be circumcised and keep the law. And here's the end result right here. James says, after the council, the other apostles and the elders, he said, to whom we gave no such commandment. Forget that hogwash. But now they're preaching it today. They have brought over the old law. They have mixed it with grace to fit their narrative, to fit what they want you to do, because they have an insatiable appetite to rule, have power over you. They have replaced Jesus. Jesus said, I have set you free. And in whom the Son of Man has set free is free indeed. In whom the Son of Man has set free is free indeed. My friend, the Jews weren't ready for him. The Pharisees, Israel today, does not accept Jesus. That is not their Messiah. They have not accepted him. And neither has most of our churches that call themselves a church. They have not accepted Jesus. The Bible said that while they themselves, they promise you liberty, but while they themselves are corrupt. They themselves don't even have liberty because they're under an organization. They're under a bishop. They're under a cardinal. They're under a pope. They promise you liberty while they themselves are ensnared. You deserve to be free, and it's only in Jesus. Jesus Christ is the only one who can set you free. If you're living under a pastor, you're living under their rule. I read it to you. To whom we gave no such commandments. And they'll twist all those other scriptures around to make them try to fit themselves and fit what their doctrine, their devil doctrines are teaching, to bring you under their subjection and under their will, not God's will. You're not free in them, my friend. You're not free in man. God did not come to bring you back under man who failed in the old law. Read Hebrews 6, read 10. You will find, and if you understand the Old Testament, and you can read those scriptures, and you can't see that these false teachers, these false preachers are liars, that they're doing everything that they can to cause you to stumble. My friend, you have got to come out. Jesus, God said, come out from under them. Be ye holy, be ye separate, then I will receive you unto myself. You have imposters today. You have fraudsters, false apostles, even in their day, false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. How do you suppose they do that? They twist the scripture. These lying spirits, these mimicking spirits, the heretics moved away from Jesus' teaching. Imposters they are. Lying tongues, a false witness. That's what he's talking about. False apostles, they're false witnesses. Oh, well, Jesus meant this. Jesus meant that. Oh, well, you just don't understand. Doctrines of devils. Antichrist. That's really who they are. They are Antichrist because they're not teaching Jesus. They're not teaching Jesus. The righteous hate what is false. Are you righteous today? Are you trying to be right with God? Then you will hate what is false. You will come out. You will leave those heresies, those falling away from what Jesus taught. My friend, it's your soul. It's your ending. I understand that the coffee shops are very luring. I do like coffee. I do like coffee, but I'm not going to go listen to false prophets just to have a good cup of coffee. I am not going to subject myself to false teaching. And I hope after today that you pray, you will seek God, you will say, God, I need to get back to you, Jesus. I have been astray. I have been led astray. And I understand that through listening to hypocrites, deceivers, and false teachers, and fake man-made religions, and that you've done away, Lord, with that priesthood. That's why you had to come, because man could not give me what I needed. And Lord, when you threw over those money changers, it was more than a spectacle in the flesh. Lord, you made a statement. Now, one of the most important and desirable things that man has on this earth is money, the value. And God, you knew that they weren't valuing you, that they were replacing you in the churches. And God, you give us an understanding through your writing there, Lord, in Matthew 21 and 12, that, Lord, when you threw over those money changers' tables, when you threw out, God, those that sold and bought, there was a message, God, for us. There was a message that we need to understand. And Lord, today, it's not in a church. It's not made with hands. It's not under a man called a pastor. It's not under a man called a priest or a pope. It's not under an organized religion. But it's through your blood, the Lamb of God that took my sins away and all those of the world. And God, we know there's a way that seems right to man. And Lord, we know there's luring things, Lord, in this life that pulls us and draws us to man. And they have made a spectacle of your word, God, and the things thereof. And Lord, we don't want to be a part of that. And Lord, today, if you'll just help us to understand and see what you really want in our life, and help us, God, to read your word, seek your spirit, be led and guided, Lord, as you said you wanted us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God, praise God. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for listening to us today. We thank the Lord for his mighty name, all that he has done. Amen. All the things that he is doing. And we just love him and we thank him. Amen. Go in peace today. And we're just thankful that you was with us today. Amen. 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 God bless you. In Jesus' name.
There I was, empty-headed, crying out from the pit of my despair. There you were, in the shadows, holding out your hand, you may be there. And now, you are